Good morning. Let's stand together and let's worship the Lord this cold Sunday morning. Amen? And we are glad you are here. It may be cold outside, but the warm love of Jesus is shining in here. Amen? Let's worship the Lord. If you're watching online today, we are glad that you have joined us. Sing with us. Get your Bible. Study God's Word. Let us praise Him. He is worthy, worthy, worthy of our praise today. Amen? Let's give Him thanks.
Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever, for He is good. He's above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise. Sing praise. With a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, His love endures forever. For the life that's been reborn, His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Forever God is faithful, forever God is strong, forever God is with us, forever. From the rising to the setting sun, oh, His love endures forever. By the grace of God, we will carry on. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing. Forever God is with us, forever. Forever God is faithful, forever God is strong, forever God is with us, forever and ever. To the Lord, for He is good. His love endures forever. Give thanks to the Lord, for He is good. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing. Forever, oh Lord, forever you are faithful, forever you are strong, forever you are with us, forever and ever.
Give the Lord praise, give Him glory. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where the streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. when the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name when the sun's shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering, though there's pain in the offering. Blessed be your name.
Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name. You give and take away,
you give and take away.
Choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. You give and take away. Lord, you give and take away. My heart will choose to say, oh, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Oh, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Well, give him praise. Give him glory today. Amen, amen. We are glad that you are here with us, worshiping with us at Cornerstone. We still have several of our folks out that have been affected by sickness. I see faces that I hadn't saw in the last week or so. Miss Kathy, for one, is back with us. We're glad to have her back with us today. And so we need to continue to pray. Rob is still out, not feeling well, and others, I'm not going to start naming names. We'll miss some folks, but just continue to pray. Whether it be COVID or not, this is the cold and flu season, amen? We're used to that even back in normal times. And so, but I have good news for you. Jesus still is in the healing business. Amen? Amen. He is our great physician, and he still moves, works, and he will heal, and he will see us through all of this. And the main thing today is if you are here today and you are sick in spirit, you are low in spirit, or you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, it is our prayer today that you will get to know him in a real and personal way. Amen? Amen. Let's come together in agreement right now and pray for that very thing together. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning so grateful and so thankful that we can come to this place, Lord God, and gather in your name, and we can worship you. Father, we pray right now for those in our church and in our community, in our state, in our country, and all around this world, Father, that is affected by sickness, whether it be COVID, whether it be cancer, whether it be just the common cold. Lord, we just know that you, Lord, are our great physician. And Father, you are our ultimate healer. While doctors and nurses do the work, we know that Jesus can only bring about healing. And so, Father, we lift up all of this going on in our world to you today, and we ask you to move and work and do it to further you and further your kingdom's work in this world. Father, we pray right now, Lord, for any man, woman, boy, or girl that may be on this church campus that does not have a personal relationship with Jesus. Lord, we pray today that you will move and work in their heart and that they will come to know you, not in religious, but for it in a real way and enter into a relationship with you. We thank you today, Father, for your mercy. We thank you today, Father, for your love. But most of all, Father, I thank you today for your grace. It's in the name of Jesus that we pray. And everyone said, amen. Amen. Let's continue to worship him today. Miss Stacy, here's your song, baby.
who can satisfy my soul like you? Who on earth could comfort me and love me like you do? Who could ever be more faithful to? I will trust in you, Lord, I will trust in you, my God. Living water rain down your life on me, cleansing me, refreshing me with life abundantly. River full of life, I'll go where you lead. I will trust in you, Lord, I will trust in you, my God. There is a fountain, who is the King? Victorious warrior and Lord of everything, my rock, my shelter, oh, my very own, blessed Redeemer who reigns upon the throne. Oh, there is a fountain. Who is the King? A victorious warrior. Oh,
Lord of everything.
Everything. My rock, my shelter. Oh, my very own. My very own.
Blessed Redeemer.
Who reigns upon the throne.
Before the world began,
above all thrones, above all wonders,
all this world has ever known,
above all wealth and treasures of this earth.
Oh, there's no way to measure what you're worth.
Crucified, laid behind a stone, you live to die, rejected and alone like a rose, trampled on the ground.
You took the fall,
but thought of me above all. Above all powers, above all keys, above all nature and all created things.
That's everything.
Above all wisdom and all the ways of man.
Oh,
you were here before the world began. Above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all wonders all this world has ever known, above all wealth and treasures of the earth.
Oh Lord,
there's no way to measure what you're worth. Crucified,
laid behind a stone,
you lived to die, rejected and alone like a rose, trampled on the ground.
Oh, you took the fall
and thought of me above all. And laid behind a stone,
you lived to die,
rejected and alone, oh, like a rose, trampled on the ground.
He took the fall,
but thought of me above all.
Took the fall, but thought of me above all. What does that mean? Well, the scripture says it like this. He who knew no sin became sin so that we might become the righteousness of Christ. Amen. He took the fall. He was the sacrifice for your sin and my sin. He who knew no sin. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
You're the one
Seated, Brother Jim.
All God's people said, amen. What an awesome worship and yes. Praise time. Amen. If you have your Bibles, please turn to Matthew chapter 16 and Luke chapter 21 this morning. We welcome you to our services here at Cornerstone. All the folks online, we welcome you. Hope you'll be able to download one of the outlines, and we're grateful that you've chose to worship with us this morning. Brian, we're going to do a song right quick, get the praise team back up here in just a few moments, and we're going to sing Soon and Very Soon. How many likes that old song? You know, it's not going to be long. Jesus is coming back. Amen. When you came in this morning, you should have got an outline entitled, Don't Ignore the Signs. If you did not get one, would you please raise your hand? Anybody need an outline? Right up here, these young ladies right here, Brother George. Good to have you girls here this morning. God bless you. Welcome. Anybody else? Praise the Lord. It's good to see everybody here this morning. Wasn't Victoria great worshiping the Lord? Isn't that great? She was standing in the back. I said, get up front. I want our people to, man, isn't that great? That's just worshiping Jesus. Thank you, Victoria. What a blessing that was this morning. Praise the Lord. Guys, we're going to do Soon and Very Soon. That's an old song that we love to sing, and talking about the second coming of Jesus. So let's stand and let's sing Soon and Very Soon together.
Oh, soon and very soon. We are going to see, oh, soon and very soon and very soon. We are going to see, oh, yes, soon and very soon. We are going,
oh, sing hallelujah,
hallelujah, hallelujah.
We're going,
oh, no more crying, no more crying there. For we are going,
oh, no more crying.
No more crying. we're going. Oh, no more dying,
no more dying there,
for we are going to see
the King.
No more dying there,
no more dying there,
we are going to see
the King.
No more dying,
no more dying there,
for we are going to see
the King. Oh, hallelujah,
hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to sing soon and very soon, one more time, oh, soon and very soon. We are going to see
the King
soon and very soon.
Soon and very soon.
We are going to see the King,
oh yes,
soon and very soon. We are going to see
the King.
Oh hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. We're going to see the King. Yes.
All God's people said, you can be seated. Be seated. God bless you. Have your Bibles. I hope you have them turned, please, to Matthew chapter 16 and also Luke chapter 21. We'll be turning there in a few moments. Matthew chapter 16 and Luke chapter 21. Praise the Lord. So much for global warming. I'd like for some of those Democrats to come here yesterday with the wind blowing 100 miles an hour and 50 below zero, tell us about global warming in Texas. Amen. Matthew chapter 16, don't ignore the signs. We're grateful to see everybody here. We still got a tons of our people out with the sniffles and allergies and whatever's going on, but we're grateful many of them are watching online and grateful for our online ministry. Say amen to that. We're absolutely reaching hundreds and hundreds of people all over America through the online ministry, and we thank God for those who are watching this morning and that cannot be here with us in person, but we're grateful for that ministry and reaching out and touching people with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Tonight at 6 o'clock, we're going to do a message on our theme for 2022, We Will Remember. And so we'll look at Philippians chapter 1 tonight, We Will Remember. And as we join worship together at 6 o'clock tonight, those who can be back with us. Let's stand in honor of God's word together, church. Matthew chapter 16. Then we'll turn later over to Luke chapter 21. If you got it, say you got it. Verse 1, for the Pharisees also with the Sadducees came and tempting desired Jesus that he would show them a sign from heaven. He answered and said unto them, when it is evening, you say it will be fair weather, for the sky is red. And in the morning it will be foul weather to you today, for the sky is red and lowering. O ye hypocrites! You can discern the face of the sky, but you cannot discern the signs of the time. Don't ignore the signs. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Let's all pray this prayer together, please. Those who are watching at home, those here at Cornerstone, let's pray this prayer together, please. Dear Jesus, please speak to my heart today. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated, church. Jesus rebuked the Pharisees because they could tell the weather by looking at certain signs, but he rebuked them because they could not discern the signs of the time. I want you to fill in the blanks. A sign in the Bible is a pointer. It is a pointer. Would everyone say pointer? It's pointing to something beyond itself. If you look at God's word, signs in the Bible either point to a person, they point to an event, maybe in the present, but many times in the future. The first time the word sign is used in the Bible is in Genesis 1. Look at your outline. And God said, let there be light in the firmament of the heavens to divide the sky, the day from the night. And let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and years. God gave a rainbow, as most of you know, when you read Genesis chapter 9. God gave a rainbow as a sign of his love and promise that he would never destroy the world again with a flood. Say amen to that. There are many signs that we could look at in the Old Testament. There are many signs in the New Testament that normally accompany the life and ministry of Jesus. Jesus' birth, and you know this, we just celebrated Christmas. Jesus' birth was accompanied by signs. Look at your outline. Look at the sign that the prophets gave concerning Jesus. The angels said to the shepherds, you'll find Jesus. They gave him a sign. Look at Luke chapter 2, verse 12. And this shall be a sign unto you. You shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. In Matthew chapter 12, the Pharisees came to Jesus and said, would you give us a sign? And Jesus said, I won't give you a sign. The only sign I'm going to give this generation is the sign of Jonah. For Jonah was a sign of Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. He gave a sign of the prophet Jonah. He said, the only sign I'll give to this generation is the prophet Jonah. And just as Jonah spent 3 days and three nights in the belly of a great whale, so shall the Son of Man spend 3 days, three nights in the belly of the earth. But just like Jonah came out of the belly of the whale, so shall the Son of Man be risen on the third day. Say amen to that. There are signs all through the Bible. If you look in Matthew chapter 24, look up here. When you study the great prophetic chapters in the New Testament, especially in the Gospels, when Jesus, the disciples, came and said one time, Lord, what will be the signs of your coming and how can we know that these are the last days? In Matthew 24, Mark chapter 13, and Luke chapter 21 are the three great chapters that Jesus speaks to us concerning the signs of his coming again. If you'll look at your outline with me, please. Turn to Luke chapter 21. And I want us to read these verses together. Luke chapter 21, beginning with verse 25. If you got it, say you got it. Jesus says in verse 25, and there shall be signs in the sun and the moon and the stars, and upon the earth distress of nations with perplexity, the sea, the waves roaring, men's hearts failing them for fear, and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth, for the powers of heaven shall be shaken. And then shall they see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. And when these things begin to come to pass, then look up and lift up your head, for your redemption draweth nigh. Guys, there are signs all around us that say that we're living in the last days. Jesus is coming soon. Do not ignore the signs. What's going on in America? What's going on throughout the world? What happened yesterday in Colleyville, Texas, with that terrorist who took over that the synagogue there in Colleyville? We're in a religious war with the world who hates Israel. This is on our own backyard yesterday. Are you out there, please? I prayed when I heard about the hostage takeover. I claimed a scripture for those Jews in that synagogue. A scripture that I claim many times in my own life. And you have and you can as a child of God. Isaiah 54:17, I prayed this over those hostages yesterday in Colleyville. Isaiah 54:17 says, no weapon formed against them shall prosper, for this is the heritage of the servants of the Lord. What did you pray over those Jews yesterday? As soon as I heard that, it's another sign, folks, we're living in the last days. Are you out there, please? There are signs all around us. Thank God it ended the way it should have ended. The hostage taker was killed. If you play, you pay. Can I have some help, please? Grateful none of the hostages were injured. But let me tell you, friends, there is more hostility toward the nation of Israel than we've ever seen in our generation. It's one of the signs. As we see these signs all around us, would you fill in the blanks? This is not a time for God's people to bow their heads in discouragement. We shouldn't be living our lives as we see all these signs coming to pass. Like birth pains, or they're intensifying and they're multiplying like the Bible said they would. But as God's people living in these last days, We don't need to drop our heads in discouragement. We don't need to shake our heads in despair. But as God's people, we need to lift up our heads in delight because Jesus is coming soon. Are y'all out there, please? I want to say that again. As we see all these signs multiplying, intensifying, Jesus said in Matthew 24, to be just like birth pains. Before a woman gives birth, those birth pains intensify and they multiply right before the baby's born. And Jesus said, you're going to start seeing signs and they're going to start multiplying, intensifying like never before. And we're seeing them every day in our world today. But this is not a time for God's people to drop our heads in discouragement or to shake our heads in despair. But as God's people, we need to lift up our heads in delight because the King is coming soon. Would you look at your outline with me, please? I had a lady text me this morning and say, are you going to remember this Sunday as Sanctity of Life Sunday? Darlene Zuma is watching the service. And Darlene, I did not respond to your text because every day for me is Sanctity Sunday. I don't just recognize Sanctity Life, the Sanctity for Life, just one time a year, one Sunday out of the year. For Cornerstone Church, we recognize the sanctity of life every day we meet here. If you look at your outline, please, do not miss this. I took time to make sure that this is in the outline so you would not miss it. Would you look at it with me, please? It says, remember this as God's people. As we see the signs of Christ coming, we can't always control everything that happens in our lives. Say amen to that. We can't always control what goes on in our lives. We have very little to say in the life of the affairs of this world, but look at your outline. We can choose as God's people how we will respond in these last days to COVID, to the moral corruption, to the rising crime, to the cultural upheaval, to the contempt for the life of the unborn, and the continual attack on the sanctity of home and marriage. And we can react in one of three ways. Would you write it down? Either we can mope, M-O-P-E, like some Baptist I know. They mope a lot. Are you out there, please? I don't like being around people like that. When we see all these signs, we can either mope. Number two, we can cope. But as God's people, I choose to look for the blessed hope. I don't mope. I don't cope. As God's people, we're looking for the blessed hope that Jesus is coming again. I choose hope, for I know this book. I know how it's going to turn out, ma'am. Just read the last book. We win. These signs of Christ's coming are all around us. Don't ignore the signs. There was a volcano explosion this week in the Pacific Ocean. Michael's doing this. How many saw it on the news? Nearly 6 miles under the earth in the Pacific Ocean near the island of Tonga, there was a volcano explosion that they could see from our satellites in space. It shook the earth 6 miles under, a volcano explosion that sent tsunami warnings all over the Pacific. Another sign of the times. You cannot pick up the paper. This week we lived it in Colleyville, Texas yesterday with a hostage situation with the Jewish people, with the Jewish nation being under attack. Islam versus not only Christianity, but the nation of Israel. Jesus said, when you begin to see these signs, lift up your head, for your redemption draweth nigh. I want you to look at your outline, and I want us to notice three things about the second coming of Jesus. Don't ignore the signs. Number one, we must accept the fact of Jesus coming. We must accept the fact that Jesus is coming again. In the New Testament, as important as the new birth is, the new birth is only mentioned, fill in the blanks. As important as the new birth is in the New Testament, the new birth is only mentioned 9 times. How many times? As important as baptism is to obedience to God's word, You don't need to be baptized to be saved. You need to be baptized to be obedient to God's word. Some of you have never been scripturally baptized and you're living in disobedience to God's word. Some of you were sprinkled as a child. Let me tell you, friends, that's not baptism. You just got your head wet, goofus. Can I have some help, please? Jesus wasn't sprinkled 8 days old when he went to the temple. He was 30 years old when he went to the Jordan River and was immersed. Because baptism is a picture of his death, burial, and resurrection. You can't get that picture when you're sprinkling water on somebody's head. Look up here, please. Some of you are living in disobedience. As important as baptism is to the obedience to God's word, baptism is only mentioned 20 times in the New Testament. As important as repentance is, let me tell you how important it is. The first sermon Jesus ever preached, by the way, the first gospel written was not Matthew. The first gospel written was the gospel of Mark. It's the oldest gospel of the four gospels. But look up here. When you read the first gospel that was written first, it records Jesus' first sermon that he ever preached. And his first sermon he ever preached was not the Beatitudes. The first sermon he preached, you read it in Mark chapter 1. He said, unless you repent, you shall all likewise perish. As look up here. As important as repentance is to eternal life, the word repentance is only found 70 times in the New Testament. How many times? 70. Fill in the blanks. I'll tell you how important the second coming of Jesus is. It's recorded 380 times. 380 times in the New Testament alone. We must accept the fact that Jesus is coming again. In the Old Testament, fill in the blanks, the Old Testament looks forward to Jesus' first coming. You read Genesis through Malachi, all the prophets are pointing to his first coming. The Old Testament looks forward to Christ's first coming. The New Testament looks back to his first coming as they tell the story of Jesus' earthly ministry. But all the Bible from Genesis to Revelation looks up to his second coming. He's coming again. Say amen to that. Don't ignore the signs. We accept the fact of the second coming of Jesus. Look up here. His second coming, look up here. His second coming was announced by angels. It was affirmed by Jesus when he said in John 14, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again. Jesus affirmed that he was coming again. The second coming of Jesus was announced by angels in Acts chapter 1 when Jesus ascended back to his heavenly Father there on the Mount of Olives. The angel said to the disciples, you men of Galilee, why stand you here gazing? This same Jesus is coming back again. We must accept the fact of his coming again. His coming attested, announced by angels, affirmed by Jesus, but attested by the scriptures. For every one mention of Christ's first coming, there are eight clear, distinct promises of his second coming. For every one mention of Christ's first coming in the Bible, there are eight clear, distinct references to his second coming. If God's word teaches anything, church, look up here. He's coming again. We had doubters when he came the first time. We got doubters today. But just like he was on time the first time, he'll be right on time his second time. Number one, we must accept the fact of Jesus coming again. Number two, if you're taking notes, number two, we must acknowledge the visual coming of Jesus again. We must acknowledge the visual coming of Jesus again. Guys, I'm not looking for Moses. I'm not looking for the Apostle Paul. I'm not looking for Father Abraham. I'm looking for Jesus. When we talk about the second coming of Jesus, we must acknowledge the visual coming of Jesus. Look what the Bible says in Revelation 1:7. Look what the Bible says when Jesus comes again. Behold, he cometh with clouds, And every eye shall see him. Would everyone say that back to me? And every eye shall see him. Say it out loud. And they also which pierced him, and all kindreds of the earth shall wail because of him. Even so, amen. Look up here, church. When Jesus comes again, he's going to come visibly. He's going to come powerfully. He's coming victoriously, and he's coming gloriously. Amen. You know what? When Jesus came the first time, he didn't come in his glory. Can I have some help, please? You see, if Jesus had come in all of his glory the first time, nobody could look at him. But when he comes again, the Bible says we'll see Jesus in all of his glory. You see, the first time he came in shame. Next time he comes, he's coming in splendor. See, his first coming is so much different than his second coming. His first coming, he came riding that donkey. His second coming, he'll be riding that white stallion. That first coming, he came to a cross. His second coming, he's going to be crowned King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Oh, man. The first time he came, we heard a baby's cry. But next time he comes, we'll hear a battle cry. Jesus is coming. And when he comes, look up here, church, every eye shall see him. Look at your outline. Every eye shall see him, the living and the dead, the saved and the lost. Heaven and hell is going to see Jesus. Think about this. Look at your outline. On a typical day on the earth, half the world is sleeping. Can I get a grunt from somebody, please? Half the world right now, you know, we're awake here in America and this North America, this part of the, half the world, on any day, half the world is sleeping while the other half is working. Are y'all out there, please? I've nearly, literally traveled around the world, been to Australia, preached in Australia, preached in Israel, preached in Germany, where's Stephen and them? Steve, where you are? Preached in Europe. You know, guys, when it's night here, it's day there. On a typical day, half the world is sleeping. And by the way, on a typical Sunday morning, half the Baptists are sleeping. That's another subject. But on a typical day on the earth, half the world's sleeping while the other half is working. Now notice this. All of a sudden, there's a sound of a trumpet. All of a sudden, there's the voice of the archangel. The sleeping man will wake up. The sitting man will stand up. The talking man will shut up, for all eyes are going to see Jesus. I don't care if you're sleeping or working. When Jesus comes again, all eyes are going to be on him. We will see him as he is. We must accept the fact that Jesus is coming again. We must acknowledge the visual appearing of his coming. When he comes, he's coming. Number three, write it down. We must affirm the victory of his coming. When Jesus comes in again, fill in the blanks, his coming is going to gladden the saints as we see our King and our Lord and Savior. Guys, can you imagine if Jesus were to come right now? Whom having not seen, yet you love, will finally see him. When he comes again, look up here. God's people will be gladdened. Another reason I'm going to be gladdened just like you is we're going to be reunited with our family and friends. I had a funeral Thursday. I got a funeral Wednesday, this coming Wednesday. I have a funeral on January 29th. And let me tell you, friends, we buried that gentleman that got saved here, and his family's watching this morning. We love you, Sylvia And Jason, I know you're watching, in Allen. As I shared at the graveside service for their husband who was led to Jesus, Ryan and I, December 3rd, his son called the office, said, "My dad's dying of cancer and he wants to make sure when he dies, he spends eternity with Jesus." And on December 3rd, he made sure he was ready. And the service is Thursday afternoon at that Allen Cemetery where we buried Brother David and Helen Mitchell. Woo! I'll give them a shout. I don't go by their house without thanking Jesus for David and Helen Mitchell. I'd never go down Greenville Avenue without going by their street by saying, "Thank you, Lord, for bringing David and Helen Mitchell into my life." Sue Easton and Carl's little girl, we buried her at that cemetery. Y'all remember her? Little Courtney. She couldn't walk. She couldn't talk. The doctor did something wrong when she was just a little baby, and she could never talk again after the doctor did something wrong. She could never say mama or daddy. She could never walk again in her life. She was here all the time, that little wheelchair, that breathing so she could breathe because she couldn't breathe. I buried her at that cemetery. And every time I go to that old Allen Cemetery, as I was there Wednesday, I think about Courtney and David and Helen and now Brother Charles. And we didn't say goodbye to them. We say till we meet again. That's the hope we have as Christians. And when Jesus comes again, the dead in Christ shall rise first. You see, his second coming gladdens the hearts of God's people. As we see our Savior and our Lord, as we're reunited with family and friends. But on the other hand, when Jesus comes again, it will grieve. Write it down in the outline. Jesus coming again will grieve the sinners as they see their judge and executioner. For those who have never been saved and those whose names have never been written in the Lamb's Book of Life, when Jesus comes again, it's not going to be a happy day. It's going to be a sad day. As they see Jesus, their judge and their executioner, awaiting for that day as they stand at the great white throne judgment in Revelation chapter 20. Key thought, fill in the blanks. When Jesus comes again, he's not coming to take sides, he's coming to take over. Woo! When Jesus comes again, he's not coming to take sides, he's coming to take over as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. I want you to turn the lights off, men. I want the picture up, please. In 1980, Brian, you were 6 years old. Where you at, Brian? I can't see you. Okay, there you are, Brian. I see that hand. Michael wasn't even born. But in 1980, Mount St. Helens volcano erupted. Geologists had warned us that it was coming. Gray steam and volcano ash plummeted in the air thousands of feet as air travel was disrupted all over America. I was 31 years old that year. Some of the men at the federal prison in Seagoville, where I was pastoring at Robin Wood Baptist Church in Seagoville, Texas, as soon as Mount St. Helens erupted, some of those guards were sent to the state of Washington to help with the evacuation and trying to recover bodies. One of them, my wife sitting back there, was Richard Reese. He's gone on to be with Jesus now, but he was one of my old deacons. His wife was one of my secretaries, Dorothy Reese. They sent 30 of our guards, 30 of them, from the federal prison in Sigerville to Washington State after Mount St. Helens erupted. Brother Richard sent me. They were there 8 weeks. While he was there, he sent me a jar, and I still got it. He sent me a jar of volcano ash. Mount St. Helens at the top before it erupted, one of the beautiful spots there on the West Coast. The geologist said, it's coming. The signs say it's going to erupt soon. Ash billowing up thousands of feet in the air. Radio and television stations sounded the alarm. It was all over the news, all over America. Loudspeakers on police cars were warning the people to leave. People fled for their lives, except old Harry Truman. The 83-year-old would never leave. He lived at the foot of Mount St. Helens all of his life. They interviewed him before Mount Helens erupted. Why aren't you leaving, Harry? He said, I know more about this mountain than anybody. This mountain's not going to erupt. Well, friends, on May 18th, 1980, St. Helens erupted. The explosion leveled everything, 150 mile radius. It leveled everything in 150 miles. The explosion was 10 times greater than our greatest atomic bomb that had ever been dropped in Hiroshima. It leveled everything 150 miles. After the eruption and people began to go in, rescuers, they found trucks and cars. Don't go to sleep on me, mister. This ain't nap time. As rescuers went to try to find survivors or bodies, trucks and cars and people were covered in 6 feet of ash. 6 feet of ash. 150 miles, everything was leveled. Oh, Harry was never seen again. You know why? He ignored the signs. Are you out there, please? Turn the lights on, please, so I can see you eyeball to eyeball now. Some of you trying to go to sleep on me. You're a sign of the time, by the way. Well, we're preaching on the second coming and judgment. People are just snoring, thinking that's okay. It's not okay. You see, the great task of the church today is not only to get saints out of bed, but get sinners into heaven. I'm going to say that again. The great task of the church in America today, we're living in the Laodicean church age. That's another sign, friends. And it makes God sick to his stomach. People are complacent about things going on in America. Jesus said, I'll spew you out of my mouth, lukewarm, while all hell's breaking loose in our nation. People sleeping while the preachers are begging people to come to Jesus. May 18th, 1980, Harry Truman was never found again. He ignored the signs. Jesus said, when you begin to see all these signs, lift up your head, for your redemption draweth nigh. Are you ready? Are you ready? Don't ignore the signs, mister. God sent an old Baptist preacher. I guess he was. I'm going to take the liberty to say he was. Noah. An old-time preacher by the name of Noah. And he warned the people 120 years that judgment was coming. And God gave them a sign. God gave that generation a sign that judgment was coming. You know what that sign was? It was a hammer and a nail. You out there, please? God gave that entire generation a sign of old Noah and his three boys as they were hammering and nailing and sawing and building that ark. Amen. Don't ignore the signs, Noah said. Don't ignore the signs. With every nail that was driven in that ark, 120 years, he warned the people. Till finally, God called Noah and his family into the ark, and God shut the door, and only 8 people lived. 8. People today are still ignoring the signs. As God's people, we must live with a sense of urgency. Wednesday night, if Jesus tarries, I'm preaching a message entitled Risk Takers. This year in 2022, this church needs to stop playing it safe. We've been playing it safe too long in America in our churches. I don't pastor any other church. But God has called me here at this time. And it's time we get out of our safe zone as a church. It's time that we are risk takers for the kingdom of God. This church is going to be challenged Wednesday. He said, why don't you do that on Sunday morning? Because it's too easy to get people on Sunday morning. The real drag is to get you here on Wednesday night in the middle of the week. It's another sign of the times. I'm 73 years young. And it's no longer time for me to be playing it safe anymore. God has planted this church as all churches that name the name of Jesus and preach the truth uncompromisingly, the Word of God. We've got to take risk. Get out of our comfort zone. Those who never give anything to the church, it's time that you start giving to the church. You're not going to take it with you, mister. We need workers in this church. Most of all, we need prayer warriors in this church. I long for the day when this front will be full of lost people like it once was. Many of you are not here during those days when this place was full of lost people. We can't ignore the signs any longer, church. What we do for Jesus, we need to start doing it now. Risk takers for God's glory. In 2022, you say, why now, Brother Jim? Because the second coming of Jesus is closer than it's ever been before. Amen. That's why. Some of you need to join the church. You need a church home, mister. Jesus loved the church. You need a church home. It's called accountability. And we all need it. It's for the time for the lost to be saved. The counterfeit Christians to wake up and realize your religion is not going to take you to heaven. Don't ignore the signs. Jesus is coming soon. I'm going to ask every head to be bowed. Every head bowed. Those at home, would you please join with us? Every head bowed, every eye closed. You're here this morning, sir. If you don't have 100% assurance that your name's been written in the Lamb's Book of Life, and don't tell me about your church membership, because that's not going to take you to heaven. Don't tell me about your I believe in Jesus. That's not going to take you to heaven either. Got to make a commitment to Jesus in your heart. Romans 10:9 says, if you'll confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord, if you believe in your heart God raised from the dead, you can be saved today on January 16th, 2022. God's recording angel has the Lamb's Book of Life open in heaven. He'd love to write your name there this morning. Don't ignore the signs. He's given you another chance to come. Another opportunity to say yes to Jesus. If God's Holy Spirit has spoken to your heart, say, Brother Jim, I want to make sure I made that commitment to Him, that I have a spiritual birthday, January 16th, 2022. I want to make that commitment to Him today. If you're at home or you're here at Cornerstone, God's Holy Spirit has spoken to your heart today. I'm going to ask you to pray this prayer silent in your heart right now as I pray it out loud. Would you pray this prayer? Dear Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. Without you, I know I'm lost. Today, dear Jesus, I ask you to forgive me of all my sins. And right now, Lord Jesus, I ask you to come into my heart and be my Lord and my Savior. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for saving my soul in Jesus' name. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. If you're at home, you prayed that prayer, friend. God bless you. You tell somebody. You tell somebody. If you're here this morning at Cornerstone and you prayed that prayer in your heart, you made that commitment to Jesus today as a testimony to Jesus. If you're here today and you prayed that prayer, would you raise your hand? Raise it high. Anybody here? Just raise it high. Pastor, I prayed that prayer. I'm not ashamed of Jesus. In a few moments, as the praise team begins to sing, we're going to ask you to come. There are some of you here today, you need to join the church. You're a Christian, but you need a church home. God's led you to Cornerstone. We'd love for you to come. He wants us to be somewhere accountable to one another. And if you need to come today, we're going to ask you to come. There's some of you need to come and pray. You got lost friends. You got lost family members. Come to this altar and lift them up to Jesus, please. We need to pray for one another. Some of us just need to come and say, thank you, Lord, for answered prayers in my life. Thank you for answered prayers in my family's life. They had COVID, but they got well. There's a lot of people not getting well. Be thankful. We have much to be thankful for. You need to come. As the choir praise team sings, would you come?
Above all towers, above all kings, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man, you were here before the world. Above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all wonders this world has ever known, above all wealth and treasures of the earth, oh, there's no way to measure what you're worth.
Fall and thought of me.